Hello friends, hi, this is Dr. Shonali, and today I will be discussing with you yet another obstetric emergency, which is cord prolapse. So let us talk about that. What is cord prolapse? Now, sometimes after spontaneous rupture of membranes, the umbilical cord can slip out, you know, through the dilating cervix and enter the birth canal, and that is called as cord prolapse. Now, if you appreciate the figure on the right here, this is a footling breech presentation. So you can see here that the feet are coming and occupying the lower pole of the uterus. And so therefore, there's a lot of space beside the feet where the cord snuggles and hides there. And just as the rupture of membranes take place, the cord can slip out. So cord prolapse is an occurrence which happens, you know, mainly when the presenting part is not well applied to the cervix. Okay, so that gives space for the umbilical cord to slip out. Now, let us talk about the clinical scenario here and see how we proceed under such circumstances. So, there is this 35-year-old Gravida 4 Para 3 lady, multiparous, is admitted to the labor room with mild pains at 37 weeks of gestation at 2 p.m. Level 2 anomaly scan shows a healthy fetus and a fundal placenta. Vitals are stable. So far, so good. On abdominal examination, the uterus is term size and the fetus is in cephalic presentation, all right, with the head 4/5 palpable above the pelvic brim. Now, this says that the head has not yet gone down deep into the pelvis. It is not yet engaged. Okay. Now, she is getting mild contractions and the FHS is 140 per minute. At 6 p.m., that is 4 hours into labor, she complains of spontaneous leakage of fluid. That means rupture of membranes has taken place. And on local examination, the umbilical cord is lying outside the vagina. So now this is an obstetric emergency. And why is it an emergency? Because the fetus is at immediate danger. The fetus is at immediate danger because of two reasons. A is cord gets compressed between the presenting part and the birth canal. And secondly, as we saw in the figure above, that the cord was lying outside the vagina. Now, all this while, the umbilical cord has been nestling inside the warm amniotic fluid. And once it comes out, due to colder temperature outside of the vagina, there can be vasospasm of the umbilical vessels. Both these contribute to reduced oxygen delivery to the baby, and that leads to hypoxia. Now, this kind of an acute event is very, very life-threatening to the fetus. Okay, so now we have to talk about how do we proceed then in these circumstances. Most importantly, and the first step should be call for help, because multiple actions are required, so we need multiple people to help you with it, okay? Importantly, you have to check the fetal heart sounds immediately, because the fetal heart rate is going to drop. There can be variable decelerations because of cord compression, so some kind of fetal distress is going to be there, and that has to be identified. So by whatever means are available to you, if it's a handheld Doppler, if it's an ultrasound, if it's a stethoscope, if it's a CTG machine, whatever there is, you have to use that to check for the fetal heart sound. Oxygen by face mask is started for the mother. You have to get the OT ready. Now, getting the OT ready and getting the appropriate personnel ready is very, very important, because you have to act one step ahead in anticipation. Okay, the baby is in immediate danger. Either we will have an imminent vaginal delivery, either we will have an immediate cesarean section. In any case, you have to get the OT ready. You have to inform the OT staff, you have to inform the anesthetist, you have to inform the pediatrician, because again, we have to act in anticipation that we might be delivering a hypoxic fetus, okay, a hypoxic baby. So everybody who is involved needs to be informed. And that is because we are looking for immediate delivery. And to make a plan ahead, we have to go ahead with the pervaginal examination. So the PV will tell us many things. The first thing the PV will tell us is what is the cervical dilatation, where is the presenting part, is a vaginal delivery imminent or not. So let's look at the figure here on the left. So the cervix is dilated, almost fully dilated, but the presenting part is very high up. Okay, these are the estral spines. And as the information provided in the question also said that the fetal head is 4/5 above the pelvic brim. So the head is quite high up. It has not descended down. And therefore, the vaginal delivery is not imminent and our mind is made up that we have to go for a cesarean section. In certain circumstances, if the cervix is fully dilated, if the head is descended down into the pelvis, like it's plus one, plus two station, and a vaginal delivery looks imminent, then one can go for, you know, vacuum extraction of the baby or forceps application and delivery. So by whichever means immediate delivery is possible, those are applied. In this particular case, we go for a cesarean section. And all this while, when everything is being done, please do not forget the consent and documentation. So one person will be doing that. And while doing the PV, take very, very important cautious precaution to avoid excessive handling of the cord. Okay. Any excessive handling is going to further promote vasospasm. Do not under any circumstances try to reposition the cord above the presenting part. So we do not have to play with or fiddle with the cord there too much and try to poke it inside and above the presenting part, because again, handling would promote vasospasm of the umbilical vessels. All right, now that we've made the decision to go for a cesarean section, we also have to take into consideration that while we are going to shift the woman to the OT, we can try to relieve the umbilical cord compression. Okay, so category one cesarean section is required. That means the delivery, the decision to the delivery interval has to be less than 30 minutes. So very quick action has to be done. And even 30 minutes of umbilical cord compression are enough to kill a baby, you see. So meanwhile, we of course have to go for maneuvers which will relieve umbilical cord compression. One of them is manual relief of compression. So while we are doing a pervaginal examination, we have to take care that we introduce our hand inside the vagina in this manner, where we are protecting the umbilical cord from compression against the vaginal walls, right? So we are gently cradling the cord and we try to push the presenting part up so that this compression can be relieved. Okay. The other thing that we can try is positional changes. Like we can ask the woman to go into the knee chest position. Going into the knee chest position causes, you know, this fetal head to, or whichever, whatever is the fetal presenting part, to fall down and fall away actually from the umbilical cord. But you can see that this position, this knee chest position, is very difficult to maintain, cumbersome position. So we can go for the Sims position. Sims position, as you can see on the right side here, is the left lateral position with the pillow under the buttocks, and it does the pillow under the buttocks elevates the buttocks and works in the same principle. All right, and simultaneously we can also go for the Trendelenburg, that is the head low position, all to facilitate or lift up the presenting part of the umbilical cord. So apart from all these things, if cord compression is not relieved even after this, we can try filling the bladder. So filling the bladder with about 500 ml of IV fluid, you know, that also helps to elevate, to lift up the fetal head away from the cord because of the enlarged bladder. So you can appreciate here that the fetal head is compressing the cord here, but after filling the bladder, the fetal part is lifted off from the cord. So filling the bladder can help. And after we have done all this, meanwhile, when we've done all this, we are, you know, shifting and mobilizing the woman to the OT. And the quicker we act, the better perinatal outcome, or the better outcome for the fetus. Now, the other question that I want to answer or ask you here is, can we, avoid cord prolapse? Yes, we can save ourselves from being in situations where cord prolapse occurs. And also, we can identify the risk factors where cord prolapse occurs and be more vigilant and cautious about those situations. So know the risk factors is very, very important. So as we saw in the first slide, that mal presentations is a risk factor. That is why women who are known to be transverse lie, oblique lie, or unstable lie, they are advised admission after 37 weeks for safe confinement. If possible, they're supposed to be in the hospital admitted, okay, because they could go, if anytime they go into labor, there can be spontaneous rupture of membranes and cord prolapse, right? Prematurity is a risk factor. Fetal anomalies are associated with both malpresentations and prematurity. Fetal anomalies like anencephaly. So these are the risk factors of cord prolapse. Multiple pregnancy, especially in the delivery of the second twin, there can be cord prolapse. High parity, high presenting part, very, very important, like the one in this question, a high presenting part is a risk factor, and therefore we should avoid ARM when the artificial rupture of membranes, when the presenting part is high, right? Polyhydramnios, a lot of amniotic fluid, that is polyhydramnios, that is a risk factor, and therefore we have to go for vigilance when we are doing artificial rupture of membranes. We have to be very cautious when we are doing ARM in polyhydramnios patients, okay? And any vaginal manipulation of the fetus with ruptured membranes, anything at all you do inside the vagina, if you apply forceps or vacuum when the fetus's head is high up, we are doing rotation of the fetus head, we are going for scalp electrode placement, or anything you can think of, any vaginal manipulation of the fetus with ruptured membranes is a risk factor for cord prolapse. During external cephalic version, there is also risk for cord prolapse. So all these are risk factors, and in these conditions we should be very cautious about the occurrence of cord prolapse. And another very, very important thing which I have left here is whenever there are high risk factors, for example, there's a woman with breech presentation who's undergoing labor, okay? Then whenever she complains of spontaneous rupture of membrane, so whenever she complains of leakage of fluid, a pervaginal or examination and FHS documentation should be done, you know, to find out for early diagnosis of cord prolapse. For example, whenever there is a woman with a twin pregnancy, then immediately after delivery of the first twin, you have to go for an immediate auscultation and PV, you know, very, very important. So these are the situations you have to keep in mind. Whenever there is a woman with high presenting part going into labor and she has spontaneous leakage, then we have to go for immediate PV and FSH documentation for early diagnosis of cord prolapse. So PV and FSH documentation after spontaneous rupture of membranes in those women who have risk factors will help us to identify or pick up cord prolapse much earlier, rather than ending up in a situation where we find the cord lying outside the vagina and we have lost precious time. So please, the important thing in cord prolapse is knowing the risk factors and how can we avoid cord prolapse, because many times, almost about 50% of the times, it will actually be iatrogenic, and there will be some missing out of risk factors or some wrong decisions taken along the way which led to cord prolapse.